Hello, everyone, and welcome back after a half-hour lunch break. We are back at it with part two of this of today's session of the Solution Club at the beginning of the new world. I felt like the first 4 hours of this meeting, I just love these long-form meetings because they're just perfect for what we're taking on here. We need to get into it. We need to go deeper than just surface level. In the first 4 hours, what did we do? We talked about a lot of stuff. It's all in the recording. But one of the things we did was we talked about what do we want to achieve, right? And let's spend a few minutes just at a minimum recapping that and seeing if we missed anything in terms of our mission, our vision. Let's just kind of feel into it. And since there's just four of us now and none of us are particularly long-winded, that's a good thing, except for maybe this Jamen guy here, but I'm sure you guys can rein me in. Let's just let it flow, right? And I say even interrupt if you need to. Let's just try it out. We're trying a new modality. No cue, jump in, let it flow, be passionate, outburst, say, Jamen, shut up. I think what you're trying to say is this, so you can shut up now. You know, that sort of thing, right? We're all, you know, very, very friendly, warm-hearted folks, and none of us are going to get offended, and let's just be efficient, right? What we are seeking to do, and I'll put in my two cents, and let's make it stone soup. Everyone just keep throwing in onions and carrots and stuff, okay? So my two cents is we're creating a network, intending it to be a vast network of video conference conversations like this one, and a whole bunch going on in parallel, and new meetings starting all the time, other meetings ending all the time, you know. And so at any moment, there will be, you know, thousands. I mean, I say thousands, but listen, there's close to 10 billion of us on Earth, right? Let's just say there's 8 billion, okay? If there were a million conversations going on in parallel, that would be one conversation for every 8,000 people, right? So imagine this vast network of, I mean, that's totally achievable, right? I mean, right now, everybody who's awake is involved in a conversation. It's just that they're not here. They're not online. They're not part of this network that we are intentionally setting out to build and expand and exponentiate. And once we have the network, oh my goodness, and we're dynamic and we're agile and we're able to jump from meeting to meeting and we're using software and tools to help us do that so that each of us can focus on where we can make them the best contribution right now, right? Once we have that, we're going to solve our problems. And we're going to look back on the few months that it took to solve our problems as collective superintelligence exponentiated. And you know what? A persistent question I predict is going to be, what took us so long? We've had video conferencing for 20 years. We've had databases for 200 years, right? What took us so long? And then we're going to get over that and simply continue on our way with collective superintelligence, right? That's how I see this going down. I'm going to go feed the crows real quick. I love to feed the crows. I feed them cat food. So just come with me. And James, jump in. You don't have to raise your hand. You can just jump in and say, Jamen, shut up.
Yeah, no, I agree with exactly what you're saying. We need to gather the numbers now as well. That's the vital part of it. Like, so I'm just going to go taking this now, as you were saying there, myself and Emery probably being not the tech phobias or anything else like that. We're very kind of, amateurish when it comes to dealing with tech. Well, I am anyway. So coming from my perspective, if I was just an average person on the street and I wanted to be drawn into these conversations, obviously it's going to have to be simplified for the average person on the street to get involved in these conversations. So again, no, like, I'm only throwing in like the fact that gathering numbers has to be done through advertising, making it appealing to people, or, you know, drawing them in, stepping news on, but making a video of the collection of different excerpts of all the videos we've been doing over the last number of weeks. They don't know when she's going to work on something on that, which is a good idea as far as I'm concerned. And then they'll throw that up on YouTube and Facebook and all that. But just basically from my point of view, anyway, if we just using the block party, they don't know, as building the platform. So I found my way onto the block party. If we can advertise the block party, the conversation part of it, and draw people in, entice them into the conversation for all the different reasons it involves. And then, we're then building a platform, a network of topics, obviously. As I said, it's a role model built in a day. So we've been doing it over the number of weeks anyway. Like, so it's, you know, as the numbers are coming in, already people are talking about, they have certain things they want to be speaking about. So it's no time for those people to put, you know, a step forward and say, all right, I'll allocate myself an hour of time during the week. Therefore, I'm going to do a video and I'm offering my, you know, anyone wants to join me for a conversation about such a topic. And you just advertise it. So all I've said is part of the agenda for the block party is just we have 1 or 2 hour conversation about building that platform and the network of topics to be separated. Anyone who wants to volunteer or start doing it then during that hour. And then we get on with the other conversations after, straight after that. We stick to the agenda topics now from now on, and the block party is what I'm saying. But one part of the agenda should be just getting the structure started.
Right.
Hey, you guys, can I interrupt real briefly just to introduce you to the Crows, to the Crow family here? And please say hello. When I call on you, just say hello to the Crows, because they practice collective intelligence.
Dick Wongs? Dick Wongs? I want you guys to meet my brothers. I talk with them on the computer, just like you guys talk with each other. So, James, you want to say hello?
Hey, hello, Crows. How are you?
That's James. That's James.
Emery, you want to say hello?
To the Crows, hello.
Good, good. Nolan, you want to say hello?
What's up?
You
know me?
Yeah, they know you. They know you. Yeah. Hello, Dick Wong. Anyway, that's how I say hello. And I bow to them and I feed them. Anyway, see, they practice collective intelligence. So I'm inviting the Crows to participate with us as we have our video conference. They, you know, they channel. They're very spiritual. So anyway, thank you for saying hello. I'm going to bow to the Dick Wongs. Hello, Dick Wongs. Love you, Dick Wongs. Please enjoy the food and then communicate with us as we're having our meeting inside. You'll know how. Just channel with us. And that's how we do it. Love you, Dick Wongs. Enjoy the food and I'll be inside.
Jamen the bird whisperer.
Hey, last week when we had the meeting there on Saturday morning, that was intense. That was intense. That really opened my eyes. I mean, I never had any idea about, Stack and, or what's it called? Slack or Stack, you know, where you post all those channels and whatnot. That, and how we were introduced there at that meeting. I mean, they were flying. They were really flying. So that really impressed me a lot, because that's the way it could be. But, you know, we're new at this.
Well, it's interesting. I would say they're flying at what they're good at, which is Slack, right? But what they're not good at is conversation, right? You know, we got on there. It was totally disorganized. Nobody was ready to lead it. They said, who wants to chair? I'll chair, right? And I didn't know what that guy was doing. It was the first time I'd been in that community. And then...
it was very cold.
It was very cold. And then, you know, as soon as I started sharing, you know, then somebody, you know, the leader of that open air thing gets on and basically focuses on putting me in my place. and saying, you know, no, we're working on a process. Basically, we don't need you here, kind of thing. All right.
Isn't that incredible?
It was incredible. And then, you know, and then what did he say? Look, I've got to go. I can't vouch for anything that happens from here on out. So this is the official end of the meeting.
That was cruel.
And there's a whole bunch of left, all of us, you know, a bunch of newcomers. That's the kind of warm welcome they give to newcomers. So basically, read between the lines, and what they're saying is this. If you're proficient at chat and you're comfortable communicating, at Slack. If you're proficient at Slack and you're comfortable communicating via Slack, come on in. Otherwise, we got no use for you.
And just to update everyone, they have over 9,000 people in the Slack now. And so Charles, who Jamen was talking about, publicly in writing, I read somewhere, basically is just like, abandon ship, because the Slack is so filled now. So they have way more people than they were anticipating or probably will handle at all. I'd be surprised if they...
But it takes forever to go through all those channels. I'm on their webpage. I'm scrolling through. I want to see what's going on, where, you know, we get more information about it. And I mean, you could be there forever and not get anything accomplished, except, you know, I see, geez, how complicated is this? This is going to explode my head. You know, I don't know. After all, you know, at the end of the day, I think we're better off doing our thing. You know? People come along. They come along.
Go, James, go.
No, I agree what Emery's saying there as well, because there was something cold about that there the other day, and there were, these guys are like running an office, basically. Like it was too, like they're into proficiency and quick, you know, typing and messaging and a lot of quick talk and everything. There was no conversation. They weren't willing to have a conversation. They certainly weren't willing to listen to what it was you were saying, because they weren't getting it. They just weren't taking it in. Straight away, their backs were up. Sorry, I don't know, the cat's jumping up. Straight away, their backs seemed to be up, which is not what the people were looking for. Like, we're looking for people who are open to conversation and willing to discuss and willing to, you know, compromise and everything else like that and help, basically. But, they're inundated with too many people. They have a lot of admins, but they obviously haven't got enough time to be dealing with these people. So,
what a difference between Diogo. You remember Diogo there compared to, well, Luke. Luke, he was an engineer guy. I mean, he was kind of keen on it, you know. He was really picking our brains. I mean, we were just there for the first time. He expected like miracles. We're looking to see what's going on, and you know, we're supposed to have everything all together. But Diogo, he was a nice guy. He stayed till the end, you know. I appreciated him, but
yeah. Well, he was curious because he was willing to listen at the start. Like, whereas the guys, the admins that were going on there, they weren't willing to listen. As I said, you know, the first guy just backed out straight away. Anyway, he didn't even want to take any responsibility for what was being said. And then the guy that persisted in talking, the guy with the dark, and I think I can't do his name. He just kind of wanted to knock it, the idea, before he even heard the idea. You know what I mean? We didn't have enough time there to give them a breakdown on what the collective intelligence was about at all there. But they certainly weren't willing to listen to it anyway. So it was a good effort from us. We reached out to someone. It didn't seem to go where we thought it would. But the likes of Diogo and those that did hang in there afterwards are the type of people we're looking for anyway. You know what I mean? We're not, you know, I think a conversation I heard with a talk that I heard by his name, it wouldn't come to me, but basically he said he did a little experiment and he asked everybody in the room. He was talking to about 2,000 people in the World Forum, and he was asking them to basically try a 10-second experiment and turn to the person on their right and basically tell them a secret that you've never told anyone before. And he gave them all 10 seconds in the audience to do that. And when they finished that after the 10 seconds, he said, put up your hands if you have told the person next to you a secret. And about 1% put their hands up out of the 2,000. And he said, I'll take it that maybe 4% of you are shy, so we'll say 5% of you told somebody a secret. Well, then you're the only people I'm talking to here. Then he said, you're my audience. The rest of you are obsolete to this conversation. Because they were willing to participate, basically. So we're going to meet a lot of people, talk to organizations that aren't even going to be willing to listen to what we have to say, especially those who will get their egos dented in some way or whatever else and get their backs up for whatever way because they think that it might be infringing on whatever system or whatever thing they're trying to do themselves, rather than accept that they could amalgamate and become part of this collective, is, you know what I mean? So we just need to get that message out better, that's all.
Well, you know, we were kind of direct, Alexander there, he was directing us to go to a couple of landing pages there, and one of them was a landing page where, you know, they kind of separated the valuable stuff from the nonsense stuff, you know? So, you know, that's an interesting channel, an interesting page. And at some point, you know, you do have to cut out the nonsense, basically.
Yeah, we carry on with the block parties as we were doing. We carry on as we've been doing. But we stick to our agendas on the block party, rather than getting sidetracked on one subject and it rolling in over into the time for the other part of the agenda. We'll just have to be stringent with that note from now on and accept that, you know, there are a lot of times not only for two-minute conversations, but there are a lot of times for agendas as well. And if there's further discussion wanted on any particular thing in that agenda, that's our time now to start branching off and opening up a little other rooms ourselves, even if there is only two or three people want to have a chat about one particular thing. That, like, as I said, Rome isn't built in a day, and that's how it'll build off from there. We could start leaving that information there for anyone who wants to watch the recordings afterwards. And the main thing is to draw people in now to the block party.
Keep in mind, get in numbers. Keep in mind, James, okay, they were rocking and rolling, you know. They're rocking and rolling. Their focus was on ventilators and you know, getting things done. They were boots on the ground. But, you know, that's the way it goes. We're not there. Jamen.
No, I'm sorry. I was just saying, I get what you're saying, Emery, but those are the type of people we want to draw in as well. But maybe not so much those people, actual people themselves, just that type of person.
But I don't think
that aspect afterwards, you know what I mean? We need text as well as conversationalists.
I can't be hung up on drawing in people, you know. We're presenting our case. We're putting it out there. We're trying to reach people to come and find out what we're concerned, what our concerns are, you know? I mean, we have valid concerns for the survival of life on the planet, you know? I mean, for heaven's sakes, all we want is a discussion with people who are willing to spend, to devote some time. You know, it's giving their time. Okay, am I going to sit here with these people or go to that link there where they say they're going to be talking about this or whatever? Am I going to make that effort, you know? And that's where we're hung up. We can't seem to find people to share our... I mean, we're in grief, kind of. I'm kind of grieving that people can't come onto the same wavelength, you know? and it's a sort of a suffering in a way. We're suffering with this, with this, to a large extent. And you know, we want. I personally, my hope is that as I'm doing what I'm doing, that I can maybe touch somebody out there who's got more ways and means to take actions that I personally can't, you know. But I do, but I've devoted enough time and energy into understanding the need, whereas they might not have been able to do so. But on the other hand, they have the ability to make heads roll, you know. Jamen.
Yeah. So Emery, I'm getting a lot of kind of the frustration and feedback. So what I'd like to suggest is let's try just painting the picture of our vision. Let's pretend that the world is listening, right, for a moment, and just express our vision. And I think this will be great exercise for us to practice and to refine our vision, because once it is attractive enough, as it becomes more and more attractive, I'll say, more and more people will join, right? So our vision is of a network of interconnected, hyper-connected conversations, right? And people become like bumblebees. A conversation is like a big flower that 20, 30, 50 bumblebees can land on at once. And we all become these social bumblebees going from flower to flower, pollinating, yes, receiving nourishment, yes, and then hopping on to the next flower, where we become ambassadors from the flower we just came from, right? And we share, hey, I just came from this other meeting over here, they're talking about that, da 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 da, right? And so it just becomes this beautiful, you know, cocktail party where people just go from circle to circle, from meeting to meeting. And over time, we all get socialized with each other, with each other's ideas, points of view, perspectives. Now, that sounds to me like a lot of talk, right? And then where do we go from there, from talk into action? And I'm just going to share briefly what I shared before. This sketch of the big picture of collective superintelligence. Yes, it all starts with talk. And that leads to understanding. And that will lead us to build and evolve a better and better map, an increasingly great map of topics and conversations. And then I keep mentioning brainstorming as a way to generate ideas for solutions, though we haven't screen shared that yet, but we will soon. And then kind of a GitHub for solutions to design them and modeling and all this. So there's plenty of work to do. Roll up your sleeves and get to work down here. But the way I see it, we're still in the first stage. I'd really like for us to be breaking ground on some of these other stages. And then really the big idea is that all this work continuously and work together. So even in these other stages where we're rolling up our sleeves and designing. So like, for example, in this stage here, design, where we envision sort of a GitHub of solutions. GitHub is similar to Slack, okay? Look, every web service is different, but I'm just saying they've got a lot of overlap. And even while work is going on in the GitHub, which is done text, asynchronous, et cetera, there can still be conversations that surround the work that's happening here, et cetera. And so the conversational domain really permeates everything and can help move along and debottleneck. If somebody's stuck here with a design problem that they can't seem to get through, right, then why not bring in folks with expertise to have a conversation about it? Let's talk about where you're stuck and what we can do to unstick you. Anyway, I'm just still sharing on the big picture vision, because for me, this is such a beautiful vision, not necessarily exactly the way I've laid it out here, but the vision of humanity coming together building a network of conversations, and then progressing through conversation, progressing through the stages of mapping, ideation, design, modeling, et cetera. We will get there, but we need to round up a bunch of committed people who get not just the value of conversation, but get how that can translate and flow into this whole big system, right? That ultimately results in solutions being implemented. So anyway, let's kind of keep it going rapid fire. I'd love to hear different people's thoughts, and you know, let's just keep harmonizing on the vision. And then I think at the right time, we'll recognize now it's time to talk specific technologies that can help implement that, right? Go ahead, sweetheart.
Can you hear me okay? Yeah, okay. I think what would really be helpful is to, part of what you just did now, Jamen, would be to redefine or clarify or remind us what the goal is, what the overriding vision is, where we're heading, and what are we trying to do? You know, where are we going? What I find really interesting but also really confusing is all these different conversations happening, and then what? You know, are we just having conversations, or are we having conversations to do a triage, to put them in different places, or are we having conversations so then we can start call the fire department and have people come in and take actions? So for me, that's really not clear. The other thing that is really clear is that I think the majority of people are still working from the old models and in the old paradigm. And so we're not really a culture that is used to sharing our ideas with transparency, right? We hoard our ideas, we covet them. And so this whole new culture that we are birthing of sharing, caring, transparency, collectively co-creating things, I think is really new. And I think that's just a time thing. I think the more we practice it and the more persistent we are, the more people will get on board. And then I just had a question, which I typed into the chat. So I don't really know Slack. I'm not familiar with that group. It looks like it's a texting thing when I looked at the website. I'm not sure. But how do they attract so many members? Like, is that important? I think we do want to attract more members. How do we do that? Is that important? That's kind of all I have for the moment.
Yeah, James has his hand up. I just wanted to comment real quick. Let's first address your first question. Why does Slack have any members and all that? Let's save that for later, but because I think right now we're going to really cover a lot of ground by focusing on why are we here? And what are all these conversations leading to? Are we just talking because we like to talk, or are we trying to get somewhere with this? So let's focus on that right now. Okay, James, go ahead.
Yeah, exactly. I get what you're saying there, no, because go back to just what you just shared there, no, on the screen there again. I get that whole process and where you're trying to go with that. And I'm all for that because I can see it has to be a process to get there. That's where people's frustrations are coming in, as you just said there. We need to draw people to the conversation, but we need people who are coming to the conversation to understand where the conversation is going. So, yeah, we are on the early stages of it, and that's why people are getting frustrated, because, you see, the talk, the conversations we're having and the topics of conversation we're having are about such serious issues that there's a sense of urgency about those issues, and that's where the frustrations on people's behalf is coming in, because everybody wants to dive in and get something done, but you can't do that until we get this platform, you know, flowing properly. So yeah, we need to concentrate in gathering the numbers to have the conversations, and we need to concentrate on how do we gather those numbers, how do we make it appealing to those people to join the conversation. So that's the main focus I think we should be focusing on. I think, again, no such things as like getting onto the World Health Organization, letting them know that there's, you know, some place that people can go to talk if they have concerns about the coronavirus, where there's like-minded people and they might get some advice and help there, and it'll be proper medical advice, because if we can get them to give us such medical advice or track it on ourselves, either way, but we share links on it. That's just one thing. But it's advertising for getting people here, like, is what I'm saying, is letting people out in the general public know that we're here. So that's our main thing, is gathering the numbers. Sorry, no, I'll go on too much.
No, that's okay. And James, just to give you a little feedback there, it feels to me like you migrated into the area of tactics. How do we get more people here? And that's a great conversation to have. But what I'd like to focus on first is, why are we here and what's the big idea, right? Because if we can be clear on that, I think that in and of itself will be attractive. And Melissa, I'd like to know if you're within earshot, because since you posed that question, I want to be able to answer, you know, make sure you're here when we answer. Yeah? Okay, great. So, yeah, Emery, go ahead.
Yeah, I like the idea of being able to meet people, you know, and listen to people and kind of get to know people and how their approach to our concerns, how they meet with it, you know, how they deal with it, you know. I get motivated, sometimes like inspired, sometimes I get like, you know, my feelings, they ride low because I fall into a certain level of hopelessness, you know, when I so certain people I listen to, you know, it's like, wow, are they way off base? You know what I mean? Like, it's interesting. It's an interest for me to see, to weigh that, to value that too. I mean, I do get involved, you know, and I gotta pick my moments, you know, most of the time, but I think in the end, you know, we're striving for saving life on the planet. I mean, I tell you, I've been listening to Guy McPherson, and I know what's up with all that. But I try to invite people to come to the Zoom party, you know, and they it's too much of an effort to download the bloody program, you know. Dude, I don't understand.
So Emery, if I can interject and give you some feedback, I'm again hearing frustration. How do we do this? I think if we slow down, I'm in a hurry, and be systematic here, I think we can make really great progress. I know it's tempting to just vent and whatnot. But again, let's start with the vision, and then we can see how do we make that happen. So what is the, and this gets back to Melissa's question. Are we here just to talk because we like to talk? Or what are we trying to achieve? So here's, I'm going to give my articulation, and I really want to ask everyone to stay on point. If you don't have anything to say about the vision, that's okay, and it's okay to not talk. But if you're going to talk now, my request is, let's talk about the vision, okay? That's my request. Is that fair? Do people accept? I think I saw a thumbs up from James and Melissa, Nolan. Emery, are you game with that?
Yeah, I'm great. I'm game with it. I'm just flicking off my camera now because I'm going to just get my food there now because it's on the slow heat, but I'm listening away.
Okay. Oh, you're listening. Okay, good to know. That's really good to know. Thank you, James.
I'm fine, Jamen. I'm game with that. It's and you're mistaking my frustration, you know. It's a realization and it's an understanding, you know, that I find useful in being able to move ahead.
Okay. All right. I just feel like we're very close to just articulating the vision. So if we just stick with that, even for a few minutes, I think we can get there, right? So anyway, I just want to really encourage that. Thank you. All right, so let's pass the ball around, short bursts, and just add to the vision, clarify the vision, right? What do we got? A network of conversations, okay? People who are passionately committed to saving life on Earth and who get that we need to fan out. We need to divide and conquer, right? One conversation is not enough. Even if we do it for 24 hours, if it's all hodgepodge, right? We can spend 24 hours talking and not get anywhere. So hence the need to go multiple, to have multiple conversations so that while one team is working on, or actually let's think of it like a tree, one huge branch of the tree that leads into thousands of sub-branches. That whole branch of the tree focuses on corona. Another focuses on planetary overheating, right? Another focuses on political transformation. Another focuses on cultural transformation. We need all of these. We need to master all of these areas. And in a way, I believe we need to master them all simultaneously, right? You know, a modern automobile has on the order of, you know, 15,000 parts, right? Let's pare it down to just, you know, let's take out the radio and the air conditioning, just those parts that the car is needed to actually run. And now we're probably down to on the order of a couple thousand, 3,000, five, let's call it 5,000 parts, okay? We need for every single one of those 5,000 parts to have integrity, to be working right in order for the whole machine to work, right? I kind of see saving life on Earth in a similar way. It's kind of like a car. There's 5,000 different parts and they all need to exist and be working properly and be properly connected. I see Nolan shaking his head. Go ahead, Nolan, what you got?
I wasn't shaking my head. I was just scratching.
Okay, sorry. Well, scratch away. And in order to get to that place where we can be working on all 5,000 parts and integrating them, we need a community, right? So I feel like here we are, we're a few people beating a drum, recruiting what's going to be an army of millions of us who can then fan out to the far reaches of all 5,000 parts of this thing. Communities can form around each of the 5,000 parts, master those parts, get them built, get them done, and then, you know, through successive stages of roll-up, we roll it up into one giant mega solution, right? So we are now in the early stages of getting the community together who can then fan out across all these multiple topics and multiple conversations and get them mastered and get them done. Right? That's how I see it. And it's, you know, it right now is just of necessity a bit of a lonely, frustrating experience because we have the vision, right? And we're trying to recruit other people here, but they come here and they say, hey, this is just a bunch of talk. Well, talk precedes action. So I, you know, part of me wants to say, listen, we need to really focus on getting people here who are willing to willing to commit to the vision along with us and spend the time necessary to build this up to a point where we have a whole network of conversations and a vast community of people. But some of us need to pioneer it and stick with it, and that's us. Melissa, you got your hand up? Go ahead.
Yeah, that was super helpful, Jamen. So thank you for that. And I guess my question is, do we just keep having all these diverse conversations, or what does the next step look like? Because it seems like we're having now vast conversations, diverse conversations, and How do we get those different conversations to keep moving forward in parallel without losing the momentum? And then as we add more and more conversations in, how do we keep those, the momentum on those moving forward? So like, how do you see this? What's the vision for the branching out process?
Yeah, may I take that? May I answer that, sweetheart? So the vision that I see starts with this conversation that we're having right now, which is about the vision. And we focus on that first, and we don't leave this conversation about vision until we're ready to. And right now we're not ready to. What I see here is we start talking about the vision, and then we fast forward into tactics. Well, how do we do this? Well, how do we do that? How do we do that? And then I try to bring us back to vision, but by then we're deviated. And then, you know, and then I try to bring us back, and it's just, it's getting kind of hodgepodgey and inefficient right now. So I'm going to reiterate a request I said a few minutes ago, which is let's try focusing just on the vision, and then we can get to tactics. How do we do it, right? And if I have to say this a few more times, I'll say it a few more times, unless somebody wants to jump in and say, hey, listen, Jamen, this vision conversation is going nowhere. Let's abandon it and do something else, like make soup or something. I don't know. Is everybody, I'm gonna do a quick poll again. Is everybody willing to actually stick with a vision conversation? Talk about the vision of where we wanna get to and forget about how we're gonna get there for the moment, but just have the vision conversation. I see a thumbs up from James. I see two thumbs up from Melissa. I see a thumbs up from Emery. Thumbs up from Jamen. Nolan, where are you at?
I just don't want it to stay there very long, because if it stays there,
okay.
Heard that, and I agree. Here's the thing. This could be a 5-minute conversation, but I keep seeing it get deviated someplace else, and then I try to bring it back, so we don't get the 5-minute task done. If we just stuck with it, it could be short and sweet. So, again, are you all willing to stick with it? It may take a few minutes, but guess what? We've burned through 45 minutes just to get to this point. Let's not burn through another 45 minutes to not get anywhere. Right? Let's spend a few minutes talking about vision, get it clear, and then when we're all cool with it, then we move on. That's
Before the 5 minutes there, Jamen, I just have a quick question. Okay. Dean McPherson, his vision. Where does that all stand?
Yeah. So that's a perfect example of a deviation from the topic that I'm trying to get done. Right? Once we get it done, we can then move on from there. And then maybe we can agree to what we talk about next. But right now, if it's just random pinball hour, oh, I want to talk about this song I just heard. Oh, I want to talk about Donald Trump. We're not going to get anywhere. Oh, Guy McPherson. Right? So again, I'm going to ask everybody. And I may ask those who aren't willing to maybe just sit it out for a little bit. But who is willing to have a conversation about our vision of collective superintelligence for a few minutes, get it clear, and then move on? Who's willing? Raise thumbs up if you're actually willing. If you're not, put your thumb down and we'll deal with that. So where are you at, Emery? Okay, thumbs up. Okay, great. Okay, vision of collective superintelligence, take 17. Let's make take 17 the one where we actually do it, okay? So the vision, a network of conversations where there's a critical mass of humanity here. We fan out and we're covering multiple topics in parallel and coordinating with the other topics that are closest to us, right? We start, the vision is a network of conversations that starts out being a conversation about all these different topics. From these conversations, a map will emerge. Here, I'm going to go back to the screen share. We start with conversations, we get deeper understanding, we start to map out our understanding. That sets us up to say, all right, now that we know what the needs are, what the goals are, what our overall objective is, what I put here is objective function, now we can start generating ideas for solutions. Then we can start designing those, modeling those, modeling them holistically, bringing in optimization so that the ultimate goal here, Melissa, is we want to generate this optimal set of solutions and detailed implementation plans so that we can actually implement them all. So it starts with conversation and it ends with implementation of actual hard-hitting solutions that kill the coronavirus, cool the planet, stop the destruction, and preserve and regenerate life on Earth. That's it in a nutshell. To get there, we need this vast network of conversations. So our vision, we could actually break our vision down into a sequential vision. First, build out a critical mass of conversational domain so that out of those conversations, we can then go on to the next stages, right? As a unified community that gets and believes in the big vision and is willing to do the dance all the way to the end. That's my opening salvo about the vision. More about the vision. And by the way, if you start talking about something that's not the vision, I'm going to interrupt you, since we've all agreed to talk to the vision and I'm moderating this. So I will play that policing function, happily so.
You're going to have to write this vision down. You're going to have to write it down.
Yeah. My vision anyway for this is exactly as you've been saying yourself, Jamen, all along. My vision is that there's a platform where, because this, we all know that there's plenty of people, most of the people on the planet are confused and pissed off and everything else. My vision for this platform is that we're offering a release, a conversational spot where our conversations, where from our conversations spring forth answers. So that's my vision. But my vision is that we start getting that message out to people as soon as possible. So my vision is I'm going to start working on that, getting that message out to people as much as possible to start joining in these conversations. Until we start having collective conversations, the information won't be inputted. So we can't jump ahead of ourselves and start solving things because we don't have all the answers. We need more conversations. My vision for this is to get more numbers in on these conversations. So that's what I'm focusing on as well.
All right. For me, that sounds like a tactic, and that's okay. But it's more than a tactic, actually, because as I just distinguished, the vision can be a vision with stages. Our vision is that it will grow and evolve like this so that we can ultimately get here. So it's a vision that includes growth and evolution as part of the vision.
Yeah, exactly. Starting with the conversations. So, you know, exactly where you're coming from. Maybe I'm not wording it right, but I'm agreeing with what you were saying. Anyway, we're at a certain stage and we need to deal with the stage first before we can move on.
The conversations are a learning process. Learning.
Exactly. We're learning. As we have these conversations, we're learning how to map out what we do next and next and next and next. So it's learning, it's coming to agreement. Today, for example, is a perfect day, perfect example of conversations which are long format and maybe frustrating for, I'm sure all of us have been frustrated at one point or another, or maybe, and some of us more than others, but it's a process that we're going through to distill down and figure out where are we at, where do we want to go, how do we do it. And I'm still in the vision part. And my logic there is if we can paint this vision, number one, it gives us a true north. Emery, that's a good point. Write it down. We've done a lot of talking about it, but it needs to be written down. So that point is well noted. I think artwork, images, that's why I sometimes get on pencil and paper and just draw up what's inside and get that out and then share it.
People are visual, you know? A lot of people, that's very high impact.
Totally, totally. So we need to have a tight visual. We need to have a tight written summary, a tight visual, the appropriate artwork that conveys, right? I beg your pardon, Emery?
Music can't hurt.
Music cannot hurt. Great idea. Yeah, let's come up with a song, a jingle. And these are all tactics.
It's a vision.
I beg your pardon, Emery?
Vision. It's a vision too. Music is beautiful. It's important in life. You know, there's the joys of life. Oh, my vision is to promote the joy that is in life, and I want people to value life. And my vision is that at some point in time, people will once again value life.
Totally. Melissa, please.
I just want to come back to the vision that Jamen is talking about rather than our own personal visions, which I think, you know, link into what Jamen is talking about. Because Emery, like yourself, and I'm sure James and Nolan feel the same way, we are appreciators of life and want to protect Mother Earth and promote joy and co-creativity. And Jamen, I think that what's happening here is you are teaching us about this process. So we're all learning a new process. And so when I teach printmaking to my students, I have to sometimes repeat things over and over again until they understand the process. And often they want to get to the finish line, right? They want to finish product first rather than understanding the whole process, which is essential to completing the project and is actually more important than the complete final piece, because it takes you on a journey of discovery, self-discovery. So I think that this vision, this big vision, Jamen, that you're carrying is really a process or a journey that each journeyman or journeywoman has to agree to want to go on. And that's just gonna take time for us to learn about that particular process, which might not be the process that we use normally. Again, because I don't think that we're a culture that participates in co-creativity and conversations that are a process to arriving somewhere. We're used to talking at each other for business with an agenda and an end goal in mind that's very specific, rather than this more open practice or creative practice where we don't really know what it's going to look like in the end. We kind of know, we have a vision, we know where we're headed towards, but the process or journey is taking us somewhere into the unknown. And so in a way, you're like a coach, Jamen. You're coaching people how to do this particular dance. And so that's just, I think it's, that could be helpful to think about it like that when you're presenting it.
Yeah, I love everything you just said, sweetheart. It's really spot on. I mean, it's helping me to kind of let go, right? In a way. And say, wow, we are on this magical journey here. And so much of it is going to be created as we go along. And I think that a lot of people who are turned away from this process are people who want an answer right now. You know, where's the link? right? You know, Kara kept saying, where's the link? Where's the link? Until I finally addressed it and said, there is no link, right? We're co-creating it here, right? So this is the hero's journey. And the people you're looking at in this room are heroes who are willing to get on the journey and commit to it and stick with it, right? So more sharing. This is awesome. Now we're talking. Now we're in a conversation about vision. I love it.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head there, Jamen, and so does, it's evolving as we're talking. This is something that's just building as we're talking. Like, so that's why, you know, our main focus now is, apart from, you know, the vision here now, is getting the numbers. It's because it's evolving as we talk. So once we get the numbers, there'll be more talk. It'll evolve quicker. But we have to have patience with it.
You know, like Melissa, as an artist, you know, I used to teach people how to create, how to make stained glass, you know, from start to finish. And, you know, my experience with people, you know, yeah, they all want it right. They all want to skip right to the end, you know. It's quite interesting. You know, there's a process. There's a vision in the process, too, that, you know, it's got to be clear.
Well, I also want to say that there is spirit at work here. And whenever I set out to make a piece of art and go in onto that journey with my higher self, if I could say, or my creative muse, I think I'm going one place, but actually the work and the process takes me somewhere unexpected. And I trust in that process now. I have faith that I know that I'm being divinely led somewhere that is going to take me into new territories. And I think we have to be courageous to do that. You have to be courageous to go into the unknown. And yet there's this great excitement and thrill of going into the unknown, because you don't know it. So that's where you can grow. You grow from that experience. So I apply that to this work we're doing here as well, is that, you know, we're all obviously meant to meet up. We're on time, in the right conversation. And I have faith that even if we don't know where we're headed somewhere, and it's going to be interesting.
Beautiful. I love this conversation because I was like really frustrated a few minutes ago. And now I just feel like, all right, we've kind of broken through to a next stage of envisioning and leadership and patience, right?
And I just want to come back to what Nolan was saying, because, Nolan, I'm kind of curious about your feeling about being in this process, this kind of fluid, amorphic sort of processing and going out into uncharted territories. Like, where are you with that? Like, where are you with that?
Where you at, man?
You got your sailor's gear on, man?
My sailor's gear. Well, I'm thinking about this quote that I came across that's like, it's supposed to be some like Chinese proverb or Japanese proverb, I can't remember, but it basically goes, if you want to cross an ocean,
you have to be willing to lose sight of the shore. And I'm definitely not comfortable with losing sight of the shore, but I don't think I think the whole point is you never will be comfortable.
Well, actually, I think you get comfortable with the unknown once you've practiced it enough. Because what happens is it's the journey that matters, you know, and not the shore. It's actually the journey that you're going on. And the great thing is that you're not on the journey alone. So I'm just saying this to kind of comfort you in a way, you know, you're not alone. And the journey is exciting because all these cool creatures turn up, you know, and you go to remote islands that you didn't know were there. And, you know, cool shit happens. And, you know, sometimes there are storms and sometimes there are mermaids and, you know, sorceresses and things like that that kind of create obstacles. But losing sight of the shore and being in the unknown, uncharted territories is a really cool place to be. That is the place of all potential.
Amen.
All possibility. And you get to be a co-creator with the unknown. And it's a really cool job, I think.
Yeah, I agree. Don't worry, like, we have to just get over your apprehensions about leaving the shore behind you, because if you don't leave it behind, you'll never get to where you want to go anyway. And yeah, as Melissa said, the cool part of it is the journey. You get comfortable with it as the journey goes on, because you start to learn new experiences.
And by the way, I think you're already doing a great job, Nolan.
Thank you.
We all love you and admire you and are really glad you're on the journey with us, with your spirit. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Nolan. If only you'd just stop talking so much.
Yeah, and you know, You mentioned about, you know, discomfort with losing sight of the shore and all that. Where we are at right now is uncomfortable by its very nature, okay? We have a vision that of a network of conversations and a full-fledged collective superintelligence growing around that network and emanating from that network into these other domains. Mapping, that's action, right? Brainstorming, that's action. Generating of ideas for solutions. Design, that's action, that's work. Modeling, that's work. I spent years of my life doing modeling. it's work, it's real work. Optimization, I did optimization too. That's kind of the icing on the cake, but very important icing, especially when your cake is dry and crumbly and has no sugar in it. You really need the icing. And finally, solutions and implementation. I mean, we've got the full stack right here. See, this is me. This is me, the frustrated inventor, if you will. And it was over, my goodness, it's been so long. It's been, I almost can't believe how long it's been. It's been over 6 years now that I've been focused on this and spending all my money on it, spending all my time. And, you know, it started with this big vision 6 years ago of solving the world's problems. And I just knew this is what I'm committing to. it became very clear to me on this very island on which I sit. I used to take kayak trips here. Now I live here with Melissa. But it was on one of those kayak trips that I kayaked to my favorite point and sat out there eating lunch, smoking a pipe, and whew, it was just clear. This is what there is for me to do. And it's funny, it's interesting, as we get closer and closer, what doesn't go away is the sense of urgency and at times the frustration, right? Which is kind of counterintuitive. Hey, we're getting closer. I should be less frustrated, right? And I am so grateful, right, that people like you, James, exist in the world who just get the vision. And I look at Melissa's response. Look at Nolan's response. We used to be so lonely with this grand vision. And so finding you who just get it and can articulate it and are out promoting it. I mean, for us, oh my goodness. It's just like, wow. You know, that gives us such a boost. And so, you know, and I couldn't even recount all the names of the wonderful people who get it and who are joining us and who love our vision. Brett totally loves what we're doing and he's jumping in and hanging out with us 2 days a week, right? The dude's incredible, right?
Yeah, and I also want to say that I love Emery's steadfastness, you know? Like, every single individual that's been on here has brought something amazing.
Exactly. Every one of us is totally unique. Emery brings totally unique gifts and a totally unique personality and approach and patience and...
Wisdom,
exactly. Oh my goodness. And you know, I'm kind of, just imagine, do you guys know what bioavailability is? Bioavailability means how much your body actually absorbs, right? So I might take 1,000 milligram vitamin C pill, and maybe my body is only able to absorb half of that or something, and the rest gets peed out in my urine or whatever, right? So that's bioavailability, how much we can absorb. I don't think I'm anywhere near absorbing the gift of all these wonderful people, right? I feel like I'm a little tiny pill bug underneath a mountain of 20 tons of sugar. I could eat it all if I could, but I can't. I can't absorb it all. It's just like, whoa, right? So I have to be recognized. I have to be cognizant of that, and we all have to be cognizant of that, and of kind of this larger principle that as the community grows, we're never really going to get to know the whole community deeply, right? And in a way, the way I see it is, we are fast morphing into a whole new reality where we are parts of a greater whole, right? Imagine being one neuron inside of a brain versus being a whole brain versus being a billion brains working together, right? That's a nice 1, 2, 3, from neuron to brain to a billion brains, right? The neuron feels quite alone and at times may even have, you know, existential worries about not being that significant, right? What neuron is to brain, individual is to this new collective, right? Relative to the size of the collective, each of us individually becomes insignificant. But just like the ant colony, where every last leafcutter ant is just fighting to their dying breath, right? Working hard. I don't even know if ants breathe. I kind of assume they don't. Lungs? No. They got to have some other mechanism. Anyway, but till they're brying, dying, whatever, they're doing the very best they can. And, you know, what a joy to be part of a whole. What a joy to be part of a human family of 8 billion brothers and sisters, right? So I think we're in a metamorphosis right now. And we talked about this a fair amount in the wee hours of Saturday morning. Emery was there sticking it out as he always does. James came back after a few hours of sleep. Thank you, James. During those wee hours, we were exploring that collective superintelligence is really two things. Number one, it's this bridge that'll take us from where we are now to where we want to get to in terms of a whole new configuration of humanity, right? As a whole, right? But the second thing that it is also the brain of that new whole. So it's bridge and brain in one, right? It's two things. And what we're doing right now is we're kind of building the bridge one step ahead of us as we walk across it. And that's, I think, a lot of what the discomfort is, because the other side, shoot, there might be a whole cloud in between us and the other side. So we can't even see the other side. And like, where are we freaking going anyway? Why are we spending so much time laying, you know, plank after plank after plank of this extending bridge, right? And for me, that's what I hear when I hear, oh, we're just having conversation after conversation after conversation. Where is this getting? But it's not until the last plank is laid that we've crossed the chasm into this magical future state that will look magical to us from where we stand now, where we are so jaded from the current model, the current paradigm of separation, hoarding, private property. I mean, all these just made up constructs that are total bullshit and omnicidal at that. And they don't feel good. They never have. They never will. Not for the poor man, not for the rich man, not for anyone. No one's having fun. I worked with Bill Gates. And since he's a public figure and all that, and I don't have personal secrets, I just worked with him, I can tell you, the guy has no peace. The guy has no peace. He can barely sleep, and then he gets up and keeps working. Right? It's like a heroin junkie who can only think about the next hit. Right? So having worked with the richest person in the world, and told him very frankly what I thought. I never held myself back in front of him, and he appreciated that. So I got a lot of respect for him intellectually. And I also respect the fact that he's deeply addicted. He's the biggest heroin addict on earth. His flavor of heroin is the US dollar.
And you can hear the baby eagle in the background, guys.
We got another
baby this year. That's really unusual. We had two babies last year, and we got another.
I was just going to ask, was that a bird of prey there? I could hear him a couple of times.
It's a bald eagle. Bald eagle.
Oh, beautiful.
Bald eagle, baby.
Well, there's another omen for you, didn't?
Yep. American bald eagle, symbol of freedom and American strength. George W. Bush, wartime president. See, what an example of someone who is just cast by the mold of those who came before him and his peers. And he had to go invade whole countries and kill literally a million people, right, are dead today who would have been alive were it not for the stupid Iraq war. And anyway, I could go on and on, but I won't. I'm just loving this conversation. Don't let me hog the mic. Just jump in, people.
Well, I mean, I don't know if there's much I can add to it anyway, other than that I know exactly where you're coming from. And I know that we, you know, again, reiterating, Rome isn't built in a day. And I get exactly what you're saying. We're building a bridge to an unseen horizon. And it seems like that, you know, I get what you're saying. It seems like that all these conversations are going nowhere, but they are. Like, I mean, they're being recorded and they're being transcribed and what have you. So we are building up information. We are building up, you know, help for other people, you know. But the conversations are help again, because they're an essential part of it. So, but yeah, people are getting frustrated. I just want to emphasize that we should all have just a bit more patience with it and with each other, because it's important that we continue with the conversations and gather more people in. That's all I say. I get what you're coming from. We can't outstep ourselves anyway, or we'd fall off that bridge that we're building.
We can't what, James?
I'm saying we can't outstep ourselves, or we'll fall off the bridge that we're actually building.
Exactly. So we're constrained, right?
Yeah.
We've always got the next plank right in front of us, and it feels like we're in a confined, solitary confinement, tiny cell, where the only space in front of us is what this foot or two of the plank that we're building on next.
Mm. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, it's about gathering more numbers and getting people in on the conversation. So we need to appeal to people. And again, I'll get on to Stephanie again. Don't know about her idea with the video and everything, because she was on about incorporating music and making it appeal to the, you know, to the right-minded people, obviously, as well. Like, but that's what we were trying to draw here. So, well, everybody really is the right mind, because every mind is needed. So, that's about as much as I have to say on it anyway, at the moment, anyway. Just have to keep going and keep going and going with it. Like.
Why it's I'm so pleased to be able to meet people, you know, through this process, you know. It's I'll be 65 in May, and you know, I've got a few good friends. Not a whole lot, and you know, this is a good avenue for me at my stage of life, and yeah, I'm glad to have met you guys.
Likewise, Emery. You know, this is the thing. Now that we're getting clarity on who we are and what we're really up to and the nature of it, right? And that feeling constrained and uncomfortable and lost and confused is part of the nature of this process, right? So now I feel like now that we've really confronted and embraced the whole of the process, and it, including its nature, we're like the Buddhists, you know, who as young, you know, monks in training, you know, at first we were very frustrated and all the pain and the hardship and the this and the that, but you know, like the runner's high, like the long distance runner who gets past the initial suffering of the first couple few kilometers and then gets on that high, right, where you just feel like you can go on forever. Right, I kind of feel like we're getting there now, and this was very, very important that we get here, because it was getting darn frustrating. Let's face it, right? And we have such urgency. So, anyway, so now that you know, speaking for the collective, now that we've transcended, right? And I just love being able to say that, because obviously each of us is in our own place, but we're also part of a whole. So embrace being part of the whole. And that means that even if only some of us like truly get it or deeply get it, the whole has gotten it. Right? So Melissa and I, we talk about being two halves of a whole orange as a couple, right? And, you know, and at times if Melissa's frustrated with something or thinks that, oh, I can't do this or whatever, I say, listen, you're thinking as an individual. Think as a whole orange. The whole orange can do this. So let's do it. Okay, so like that, man and woman are part of a whole orange relationship. Now expand that to us as a team, to us as a community, and we're going to expand that out, right? This love virus is going to infect everyone. Voosh. And, and, you know, wow. And now we're humanity as a whole. We are operating at the level of humanity as a whole. And that's the way we need to see this. It's as simple as that.
different segments coming together in one orange.
Exactly. And then within the orange, there are those little sacks, right? Those little, you know, droplet-like sacks. And then those are made up of tissues, and those are made up of clusters of cells, and those are made up of cells, and those are made up of organelles, and all the way down. All the way up and down the stack. The bottom line is we are one whole. One whole universe, one whole creation, right? And sure, we can analyze parts of it. We can even experience being Melissa and me. Yeah. We are family. So,
just to let you know, I'm addicted to oranges. I just, I got a stack of them, two bags.
Beautiful.
Big ones and the small ones.
All right. Emery is an equal opportunity orange eater. You can be big, you can be small. He would eat you.
No, but I have health issues, you know. I'm only taking in a liter and a half of liquids these days due to heart condition, but I have to watch my liquid intake. So I'm one of those at risk with this virus.
Gotcha, Emery. Well, let's keep you safe, brother. Let's keep you safe.
At some point, we're going to get this artificial intelligence online, Jamen.
Totally, totally. See, it's going to be an integral part of it because just consider, okay? Consider the scenario where, you know, there's, say, I don't know, 10,000 of us who are going from conversation to conversation, and we're working on all these different pieces, and it's working. And new people are joining every day by the hundreds, and it's working and it's growing. And yet, so are our problems. Melissa and I were talking about the impacts of the coronavirus just yesterday. We were talking about it as like a train wreck, that if you imagine it happening in slow motion, first the engine crashes into, say, the mountain, or, you know, a bunch of giant boulders that have collapsed and tumbled in front of the track. First the engine crashes, then the car that was right behind it starts crumpling into the what used to be an engine, and then the car that's behind it, and then it just becomes this, you know, cascading effect, you know, bouncing through, tumbling through all the cars. So we have to get out in front of that. So we're going to have urgency to go even faster than fast, right, in rolling out these solutions and implementing them. We're going to have to go lightning fast at times. And that is going to drive much more efficient and rapid achievement of the following. Okay, so I want you to hang in there with me for a couple of minutes, everybody. and I'm going to trust that James is listening. I'm sure James would tell us if it was otherwise. Yeah, don't worry, James. We know you're listening, and we know you'll tell us if it's otherwise. But here's the deal, okay? Imagine that there's a sequence of actions that's going to get us from the state that we're in right now, early stage train wreck, all the way to a completely healed and transformed Mother Earth and humanity, right? Good to go for the long haul, saying, whoosh, that was a close one. I'm sure glad we did what we did. Imagine there's a whole series of steps. And imagine that for each of those steps, let's just call them step one through a million. For each of those steps, there are things that are naturally in the way. Duh. I mean, that's just life. That's kind of the definition of life. You want a whole bunch of cool stuff, and there's stuff in the way at every stage, and you have to work at it, right? Okay. So imagine now that, you know, humanity is on step 17, right? And it needs to complete that step so it can go on to step 18. But right now it's in the middle of step 17, and it's meeting with resistance. It's meeting with barriers, with barricades, with problems, with issues, with lack of this, with lack of that, etc. Okay? Now imagine that there is some set of human beings, an exact set of human beings, which, if that set were all meeting in one meeting, looking at this current barrier that it's on, right? It would be able to kick that barrier down with one kick, with one, say, I don't know, half hour conversation. Okay? We're talking about one barrier within step 17, okay? And then it knocks down that barrier and gets to the next barrier within step 17. And it might be the same team, or it might be the same team with five people removed and another five people in. Or it might be a whole different team with some overlap of the previous, whatever, whatever the case. For every barrier, for every problem, there is a team that can solve it, right? And let me give you evidence of that, okay? Way back in the 1960s, the decade when James and I were born, right? Way back in the 1960s, and for Nolan's sake, I'm going to say, ba-da-na, ba-da-na, ba-da-na. And for Emery's sake too, because Emery likes Emery loves music. Everybody here loves music. Anyway, way back in the 1960s, they had a crazy idea of actually going to one of those round objects in the sky and coming back. Are you crazy? And guess what? They assembled a team to do it. That team was called NASA. And with that, I rest my case. I don't care what the barrier is, right? If we could do that in the 1960s, in 2020 with all this technology, you know, get out of here. Of course we can do it. James, go ahead.
Yeah, and just to add to that, dear Jamen, during those early days in the 1960s, I'm sure you remember the Apollo missions, and we all know the fate of the Apollo 11 mission and Apollo 13. So when they came up with incredible problems, especially when they had men out there in space, their collective intelligence got together and solved them as well. Like, so that's a good example of it too.
Exactly. Oh my God, what a great example, right? Now, they had all the staff and contractors and everybody in the military, and everybody was there standing at attention. And they handpicked, you get inside that, you know, model of the spacecraft that's here in Houston, and mm-hmm. reverse engineer away, and you've got all the resources you need. So they just, that's it right there. Apollo 13, that's our example. Because different from the Apollo program itself, they had years to get, you know, to launch the first rocket to the moon. And they weren't going to hurry it. They were going to get it right. They had set an aggressive deadline of the end of the decade. But Apollo 13, they didn't have years. They didn't have decades. They had hours.
Yeah, and they could only use what they had on board that ship as well to come up with it. So they had to improvise. How did we build an air filter out of a sock and a bit of machine? You know what I mean? So that's collective intelligence. That's exactly it. That, you know, that's what we're trying to develop here. Well, that's what we are developing here. We're just an embryo at the moment. That's all. We're just an embryo with patience. That's all we need to be. You know what I mean?
Totally. 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 Yes, sweetheart. Go ahead.
I've got to check out for a minute because Ida Culver doing a second round of coronavirus testing. I want to call my mom. So I will jump back on later.
Okay, my love. Give her my love. And,
all right. See you guys later.
See you, Martha.
See ya.
I like your idea of the teams, Jamen. There is a team, and I've always suspected that, you know, that there's a team, you know.
Look, there's a team for everything, for every barrier. We are the team for getting through the barrier that we're navigating right now. It's as simple as that. It's no different.
Yeah, and I'm just going over for a cup of tea, so I'm listening.
Awesome. Thanks, James. Thanks. Really appreciate that. We are the team. We're the ones who are here, right? The universe said, all right, I want to find those people who are willing to stick it out for 6 hours plus and not give up until this thing is figured out. What are we figuring out? How do we move forward? And we're figuring out the nature of what we're doing, what we're taking on, the nature of the mission. Some very important things about it. But anyway, back to, I'm going to take a deep breath first and mute my microphone. And then whenever everyone else has had a chance to speak, I will be happy to continue. What's you laughing about right now? I'm just kidding.
So I just poured out the tea, but as soon as I poured the water into the cup, I realized I need to go to the bathroom now as well, so I'll be back.
All right. Well, I trust you're listening the whole time, right? Anyway, you don't have to answer. Yes, that's awesome. That's awesome. Thank you.
you said Dylan was gonna have something to say.
Nolan always has something to say.
Nolan, sorry, Nolan. Thanks. Nolan, Dylan, I have in my mind Dylan. There was a picture, his picture, you know, it's like he could have a guitar in his hand there. The way he poses there. I like him. I like
that. Have to see it again to visualize.
You know, I have a picture like that somewhere, but playing the guitar, like Heartbreaker. I was a lot more onto the Fukushima thing when that happened. That was the brunt. And before that, the 9/11. We all seem to get onto these events. They have their high impact on us, and we devote our energies and our time to resolve our understandings about them. Interesting. This is the best so far, I think. Hello, at least I believe we have a lot of potential for success. And it's important. It's important, I think. It'd be good to win.
I mean, look, what's at stake here is literally the existence of complex life on Earth or its total collapse, right? These ecosystems have become so interdependent. And the planetary life supporting systems, like the hydrologic cycle, the greenhouse gas layer, all this are so compromised. The ocean as a platform for aquatic life, right, is so compromised. So we have just been wholesale destroying the very fabric that holds life together. And what we are doing is we're building a bridge from this death spiral that we're on, including an off-ramp, which we have to take in time, and then take it all the way through the bridge to the state that we dream of.
I'm so blown away by the way you're able to articulate things, Jamie. You know, I mean, seriously. I mean, I listened to Guy talk there for ages, but you know, I've seen you both together in a lot of times. You know, so far, and you've got your way, man. It's so clear. Really, I mean, I take it. Believe me when I tell you that it's just. I mean, it's a put you two together, okay. It's like I can't think that's way more than nuclear. Well, there is no bomb created yet.
Dude, totally. My biggest beef with Guy McPherson, he doesn't come here and hang with us.
Yeah.
And here's, let's get to the root of it, because we need Guy.
That bugs me.
This is life and death for all of life. So, you know, you can imagine how far I'd go to protect my own mother's life. Now multiply that by a countless figure of mothers. Every one of these crow babies out here has a mother somewhere that loves it, right? It's time to get real here. Okay, so what's the deal with Guy? Guy, and I'm going to talk straight to Guy here. How about that? Boom. See, we're creating a whole new vector of communication. Here I am in a meeting with you guys, and I'm making a phone call to Guy that's going to land sometime in the future when we send him a link to this video. This is yet one feature of collective superintelligence. The video call, the group video call into the future. It'll land at some point in the future whenever Guy watches this link. Okay? So, Guy, here's your video call into the future, and let it be a very near-term future. Speaking of near-term stuff, right? Okay. Guy, here's the deal. You are still playing the separation game. You're seeing yourself as separate from us. You're the professor, we're the students. You have office hours, the rest of the time you're inaccessible, right? Meanwhile, here we are, playing dominoes and passing around a joint here in the ghetto, and you're too cool to come hang with us. But the action is happening right here. That's the problem, Guy. We need you here, and you need to be here. Mother Earth needs you here. Dude, Guy, you hang with us here, this thing is going to blow up, right? And it'll be because of you. You want credit? There's your credit. giving credit where it's due, right? You got a lot of followers. And if you start hanging with us, a whole bunch of people are going to start watching and talking about it. And then they're going to start jumping in. But if you don't set the example, how are the others going to follow you, Guy? That's what I got to say to Guy. Anybody got any postscripts to tag on? I'm going to pause it, actually. I'm just going to pause it for a minute. Okay, go ahead, James.
I'm willing to send ice cream, man.
There you go.
Tons.
Tons of ice cream are offered for memory. James has something to say. Go ahead, James.
Yeah, I'm just saying I love your talks. I look into Guy's talks all the time, and especially his new ones there, where he's trying to give as much feedback as he can to people who email him. And I love the way he approaches it. I love his sense of humor, his dry sense of humor. Typical Irishman. There must be a bit of Irish in him somewhere. Yeah, I agree with Jamen. You're needed here. Even your negativity is needed here, more so than anything, I suppose, because we need people to, we need people to get on board with the conversations here. No, I'll keep this short. So even if you haven't got the time, maybe you could give us a shout out while what you're doing on your 3-minute videos or 4-minute videos or whichever the ones that you put out there during the day. Thanks for your time and appreciate what you do.
Beautiful, beautiful. Yeah, add on, Nolan.
Yeah, I just want, Guy, I want you to imagine and just think about the people that don't realize the urgency yet, but are necessary to convert in making all this happen, and how much more meaningful that information, the information you have to share, being conveyed to them like in an actual conversation right there with you. They can ask you questions. They're hearing it straight from you. You're answering a specific question they're asking. That's a totally different experience than, you know, watching a video that was filmed for who knows how many people. And it's kind of a, you know, I don't know. It's just totally different. And I think it could go a long ways in helping get the attention of the people that really need to be here at the table. There's definitely something really powerful about having an actual conversation about it. And this technology enables us to do that with pretty much anyone, anywhere. We need you here.
Well, I second that. And I would like Guy to know that, his videos are tremendously powerful. And I review them often. It's important that continues, you know. But you know, at the same time, it's nice just to connect with a little bit more to to Emery and to Jamen and people like us here. You know, we don't have all the solution, but you know, we're trying. You know, we're trying to be clever. We're trying to be clever, Geek. But don't take that away from us. We'll try. Keep trying to be clever and find solutions. Be nice to see you here.
Beautiful, beautiful. And Guy, obviously, when Emery says Guy, he really means Guy. And Guy, you have brought us all together. You're bringing this whole community together. You've changed our lives. You continue to change our lives. You've completely transformed our lives. Completely We live in a whole different world thanks to you, in a world of reality, and in a world where we can do something to create a new reality together. And another thing I'll tell you, Guy, is, you chose to take early retirement from the university, but, you know, we've had deep conversations about how much you love teaching. And it's not just something you do, it's who you are. And your style of teaching that you pioneered at the University of Arizona, we need that here. And we need you here practicing that style. And just like a class at a university, the beauty of it was you met two or three times a week with those students and continued the conversation. So there's a repetition, right? That's extremely important. We need you here, Guy.
I would just like to add to that I've heard you say before, Guy, that you're no longer a professor, but I would like to remind you that you're still a teacher because you do and have taught so many people so much, and that's why we believe there are so many out there that would be willing to tune in to listen to and get an opportunity to speak to you on this platform, so that we can draw more numbers in here. And I think that, you would be a complete, not a benefit for the whole parcel and package that we're trying to offer. So, but again, appreciate everything you do. And I know you're busy.
Yeah. Oh, and actually just one correction. Professor Guy McPherson is still a professor. He's professor emeritus. So he's not teaching classes actively, etc., but he still has an office at the University of Arizona, mailbox, email, all that. He just is emeritus. That's all. So he still has standing as a professor. Anyway, but your point is absolutely golden, James. And what an opportunity to teach and lead them and lead McPherson style conversations with the classroom. And that's how his teaching was. He didn't profess, he didn't present. He led conversations, which is exactly what we do here and what we need him for. We need his knowledge here. And his setting the example. Back to you, Guy. We need you here, and we need you to set the example. So many people love and respect you, and they would follow you off a cliff. So they will also follow you into this video conference.
Exactly.
Just to reiterate, I didn't mean any offense there by saying that he wasn't a professor. I know he's still a professor, and I know he's Professor Emeritus, but I heard him once mention that he's no longer like a professor in the sense that he teaches. But I just like to say that I believe he's still teaching us all anyway.
That's right. And what I'm saying is come teach us in the McPhersonian style, right, that you pioneered at the University of Arizona, right, that won you such accolades, distinguished teaching, all the highest accolades you could possibly get. Across multiple departments. I mean, I don't think you get higher accolades, higher awards for his teaching. So we are in the business of orchestrating the saving of life on Earth through a series of steps, right? What did I postulate? Let's just hypothetically, a million steps from here to there. And we talked about earlier in the video, this video, about those specifics, that there's a team, not just for every step, there's a team for every barrier within every step. And there's a team to set the vision for the step and the scope and the constraints and whatever, right? And in fact, there can be teams working on the million different steps in parallel. Why not? So that when the dominoes go, they just go, they're just done, like a relay race. Right? Different teams have different steps already mapped out. That's what we're talking about here. It's a complete paradigm shift from living as a bunch of hyper-competitive, primates who are all enemies of each other and all trying to hoard from each other How the hell are they ever going to get anything done? Well, the only way they get anything done is that they organize into gangs, basically. Corporations, companies, they're gangs. Large gangs, small gangs that say, all right, we don't like this any more than any of us, any of the others, but let's get out there and do this. Let's get our piece of the pie for us and ours, right? And it's gang warfare. It's international warfare. It's warfare between siblings. It's warfare between students in a classroom competing for the A+, right? And the letter of recommendation, et cetera, et cetera. On and on and on. It's an omnicidal, finite game. And we're transforming it into an infinite game. Somebody has to. So it's our community. We're a part of it. But we're still a fragmented community. We're trying to bring the fragments together. And so my next message, thank you so much, Guy, for listening. That's all I have to say to Guy. If anyone has any final words for Guy, now's a good moment. I'd like to give him, thank you. I'd like for my next message along these very lines to be to Daniel Schmachtenberger. Daniel, we need you here in this conversation. You are so brilliant. You are so well-read, so studied, with such deep knowledge, hyper-connected knowledge. You see patterns and all kinds of great stuff, and you're plugged into all kinds of amazing communities and conversations. Join us. Guy's going to be here. Right? That's what's called the Hollywood party effect. You get everybody to come because you get a few leads. Anyway, my goodness. With Guy here, and Daniel Schmachtenberger, and Elon Musk. Elon's in this conversation. Elon, we need you here. We need you here in this video conference, in this network of conversations that we're building to save life on Earth.
We also need the likes of Jim Bendel and his deep adaptation program.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Keep mentioning the names, right? And let this be an invitation for all of you
to join. Kevin Hester. Kevin Hester. Pauline. Yeah. Pauline, come on down.
You know, yeah, Pauline.
We like your books. You know, very, very nice.
Yeah. Guy and Pauline. We need you both here. Yay, we need you here regularly. Yay Tao, Dr. Yay Tao of Harvard, especially now that Harvard is shut down. Right?
And Roger Hallam.
Yes.
Oh, there's so many. There's so many people. We could put out a list. We'll put out a list on Radish.
Great, let's do that. Let's put out a list of people we're inviting, and then we can send this video to all those people. So if your name is on that, if you're receiving this email, you're on the list. And let's publish the list so that people can read through the list and say, oh, I know this person, or I know that person, or I know this person's cousin, or my friend went to school with that person. Whatever it takes, right? Let's get through to all the people we need to get through. Let's get them here into this conversation. Because what we're proposing is a way to holistically and simultaneously build out the entire series of steps. Literally, if it's a million steps, it's a million steps. So be it, right? We can get so efficient at organizing teams to navigate all of the barriers and constraints, right? And missings. Oh, we're missing this. Oh, we can't do that because we don't have this. There are teams that can navigate every single constraint, every single barrier, every single missing, right? And what we are proposing, in a nutshell, is the machinery to assemble such teams essentially at will, and more specifically, and I'm just going to make a very specific tangent to iLog Software, ILOG. It's a French company. And they got together the best French mathematicians who are among the best mathematicians in the entire world. And since Napoleonic times, they were way ahead in math. Anyway, they got together all these French mathematicians, geniuses, and put together this optimization software, which I've used on multiple occasions in my professional practice for both modeling and optimization. Anyway, iLog. So like with iLog software, one of the things that one of their famous success stories was optimizing for personnel, for example, for airlines. This flight's late, this other one has this issue. Oh, now we need to change planes, whatever, change docks. They optimized all that, right? Including for personnel. Oh, this person called in sick. You know, again, this other person's delayed from some other flight and whatnot. They could just re-optimize on the fly very efficiently. And so likewise, with our software, with our system that we're developing, we are going to be able to corral all those available people together to form the optimal teams for each problem, right? And just like we've been over the past few years building out all the steps leading up to this moment, from here on out, there's a whole bunch of other steps. And as we build this out into a proper collective superintelligence, right now it's a collective intelligence with, you know, on the order of a few hundred members, most of them very part-time. And that's part of what we need to, you know, ramp up is people's commitment here. And, but because everyone's grounded at home, it's now easy, right? No one's going anywhere. So there's a lot more flexibility, right? And since you're with your family 24/7 anyway, they're not going to miss you for half an hour if you pop over onto it. In fact, it'd probably be a relief, frankly. So give yourself a break and give them a break and jump in. I mean, we're not asking for much. We're certainly not asking for money. We're asking for people to join the conversation so that collectively humanity can come together and we can complete the process of mapping out all million steps or however many it is, right? And modeling it all out, simulating it all, right? So we can map out exactly what's going to happen. Now, I can hear the laughter. And, you know, it's just like on a road trip. You might try to program in your car to do every turn exactly. And, you know, half a mile down the road, you're going to be off by 5 feet and it's time to manually correct. So obviously it's not going to be perfect, but you know, so it's more like rather than try to pre-program every little turn from here to New York, do it the Tesla way, right? Where you basically use AI to constantly, you know, recalibrate as you go. So we'll definitely recalibrate as we go, but that does not alleviate us from the responsibility to have full spectrum, full vision, right? Modeling and planning from here all the way to the end being once we've reached a stable, steady state of a cool planet, back down to ice house state, pre-industrial global average temperatures, Antarctica with integrity, Arctic sea ice restored, Greenland sea ice restored, et cetera, et cetera. So once we've restored the planet to a state of integrity, temperature-wise, virus-wise, and humanity-wise, we need to completely reconfigure ourselves. Transform everything from what we eat to how we live to how we consume to what the economy is all about. The reset button is being pressed right now with this coronavirus, grounding the global economy, grounding humanity, and putting us in, frankly, in a very precarious state across multiple dimensions, such that if we do not convene planetary collective superintelligence to holistically solve all these problems and completely transform life on Earth. If we don't do that, we're going down so fast. It's actually quite predictable. And Guy, we need you here to help us predict that and just make it very explicit. The picture updates and changes every week. Well, we need the updates. We need the weekly updates. So,
I'd like some updates for sure.
So back to the open invitation, back to the invitation. It's really an invitation to all of humanity, and we're making some targeted invitations, and we're making them publicly because it matters. It's really not optional. We really need you here. And the sooner you get here, the sooner we can clean this mess up, right? And save life. In fact, the life you save may be your own, right? Given where we're headed. The life you save may be that of your children, other family members. I'm talking to all of humanity here, right? So, yes, we're going to be making a lot of targeted invitations very publicly. And but the overall message to all of humanity is we are right at the cusp of doing this. The conditions are perfect for doing this right now. And they're not going to get any more perfect. They're only going to get less perfect over time, right? As our world continues to fall apart. Right now, you know, the House of Cards is shaking, but it hasn't collapsed yet. We can avert collapse, right? We can reinforce every intersection of cards in the House of Cards, reinforce it, stabilize it, cool it. Cool the planet. Halt the destruction of Mother Earth. Halt the destruction of ecosystems and extinction of species. Clean up the ocean. Cool the planet. Refreeze the Arctic. Restore ice on a planetary scale. All of this is at hand. These are the stakes. We can go in one of two directions. We can go the route of collective superintelligence and solve all of our problems and get us to a state of life and of thriving and of love and of compassion and connection and no sixth extinction, end the sixth extinction, cool the planet and live in a beautiful world, to paraphrase Charles Eisenstein, that more beautiful world our hearts know is possible. We need to get out of our way and get out of the way of our hearts and let our hearts come together and sing together and together co-create and paint this beautiful painting, this beautiful picture of the life that we can achieve. It's totally within our grasp, but we need to agree to come together as a collective superintelligence to achieve it. We're not going to achieve it by not coming together. Each of us doing our own thing, building our own bunker. You know, how I save the world by building a bunker in my backyard. How come you don't see books by that title? Because they don't exist. We're not going to save the world by each of us looking out for our own ass. We need to come together.
And we guarantee that there'll be lots of love here.
Oh, absolutely. This is a love fest.
And just to clarify, there is no might save your life or might save the lives of your children. You will be saving your life and you will be saving the life of your children and future generations if we're lucky, if we come together in time.
You know what I love about this? One of the things I love about this conversation, it is so spontaneous. And you can watch, we're now almost 7 hours into this conversation, right? And we were quite frustrated a couple hours ago, right? It's all recorded, right? It's not like this is any great secret. We were quite frustrated. Now I feel like, tell me, you guys, honest to God, I want each of the four of you to tell me, do you or do you not feel like that long distance runner who's broken through, right, and is on a second wind, right? And I'm talking not like, all right, let's go for another 10 hours. No, not like that. But, you know, we're going to need to break for dinner at some point and all that good stuff. But what I am talking about is, don't you feel like you're at a second wind in terms of that, like, clarity and just purpose and commitment and passion. Anyway, share where you're at. That's where I'm at.
I'm motivated, you know. That's where I'm at. I'm motivated and I'm looking at that list. Making a list. Like Santa Claus. You know, check Check it twice.
Well, no, but no doubt about it. Anyway, if anyone looks over the recording, they're going to see that there are times that you can see there's genuine frustration in people's faces and on their minds and that. Like, so, yeah, but I mean, you can't have a conversation and you can't have a meaningful conversation anyway. And you can't try to resolve situations without there being moments of frustration. That's all part and parcel of a conversation. As long as it's kept respectful, then you'll get through those frustrations and, you know, you'll have results at the end of it. They may not be exactly the results we all want, and they may not be exactly, we might not have exactly got to the place where we want to get. I'm not saying that didn't happen here. I'm just saying that at times it'll be frustration, but you know, I feel that we've made progress again, and I feel more uplifted, like Jamen was saying. I feel like we've got a second wind. I don't mean to carry on for another 4 to 5 hours either, but I just do feel like that we've pushed through, and we're making more progress. So again, I reiterate, we just have to have patience with this, but we have to persist.
Love it, James. Thank you.
I totally hear you with the second wind, and I think it makes a huge difference that we're in this more intimate setting now with the four of us, both in terms of number of people, but also everyone here has been in it for a while. We're not initiating anyone. And I think it was really powerful that I think it was Jamen that opened it up to us talking to people outside of the conference. And opening it up to, yeah, I think that was really powerful and brought a lot more energy in the conversation.
Well, it was also an example of what we can do with collective superintelligence. Right? With those birds flying up in the corner, right? We can take flight with this medium, right? We can do videograms to the future. We can do lateral communications to other conversations that are happening in parallel. We can cross streams, for crying out loud, and then uncross them, right? Think the under... Huh?
No, sorry, I thought you were finished. I was saying, and more importantly, we can spontaneously react just like that, like we just did through our conversation by throwing out those invitations to Guy McPherson and others. That was spontaneous reaction to our conversation. So again, like, that's the importance of it. Sorry.
No, that's fine. And let's continue to, you know, co-invent these new forms, these new vectors of communication and of information characterization and tagging and, you know, with hand gestures. You can, like, if I do this, it means I'm tagging that, right? And, you know, of course, you can see the AI recognizing that visually as that kind of symbol. And then, oh, what is he trying to say? And then I say, hashtag, right? And invitation to, you know, all the people we're inviting, right?
Have you noticed that especially like on Facebook, they don't like being tagged? I mean, I've got all these friends, you know, a lot of friends, a lot of contacts that I've made in the art community, a lot of stained glass people, and
yeah, and they don't like being tagged. That's the point. Just, well,
don't want to be tagged.
Well, then check it out. in our system, in the collective superintelligence, let's let everyone specify whether they want to be tagged or not. And if you don't want to be tagged, you don't get tagged, right? Like, you literally cannot be tagged. It is restricted, right? Would that solve that? Of course it would, right? So whatever problem we can think up, see, now that we're unconstraining ourselves in terms of communication, let's also unconstrain ourselves in terms of co-creation. And let us speak these requirements, design requirements, design specifications, like the ability to opt out of tagging completely, right? Let's speak those into desired requirements. I might be desiring this, making this a requirement. No, and if no one else agrees, probably it won't happen, right? But at least I'm able to offer it.
It's not the end of the world to be tagged, though. You know, I don't mind being tagged at all, because if I don't want to have it on my page, I won't put it on my page, or, you know, I have something else on there.
But yeah, look,
I don't mind being tagged.
You're talking about mitigating tagging after the fact, right? Obviously, there are people who don't want to be tagged in the first place. You get what I'm saying. Anyway,
get all wet when you stick your toe in water. It's wet. You're going to be wet. You know, you come on a social platform and be social. You have friends. You've made contact with people. You know, come on.
All right. I hear what you're saying, because even if I opt out of tagging, what's going to prevent James from mentioning in a Facebook post, hey, check out this video that I was on with Jamen Shively?
Exactly.
Right? So, there's a whole myriad aspects to this medium that are just nature of the beast. That just come with the territory. And that obviously has to be acknowledged. But I'm just saying, within those broad confines, we do have a lot of leverage of, you know, giving people facilities for X, Y, or Z. And, I'm just saying, it's extremely valuable to imagine, to collectively imagine what can be, right, as possibilities. Like I said, with the anti-tagging feature, maybe we implement that, maybe we don't. Right? I'm not trying to define that. I'm just saying it's an example of a possible feature. And so let's get very facile with coming up with possible features and just articulating them with full faith that this will be faithfully transcribed in the future, you know, by the appropriate time in the future, and faithfully indexed so we can access this information efficiently, right? In other words, let's imagine the system that we want. And let's imagine the modalities of communication that we want by practicing them and speaking them into existence.
Well, take note of this, to wrap things up probably, is that I've tagged Guy McPherson many times, and he accepts to be tagged, and I respect that a whole lot, and I love him. They give him the invitation. He's on the list, and everybody, you know, you're welcome to come.
You know what? What I'd like to do is, and help me out, you guys, in thinking this through, but I'd like to send this video to Guy as an unlisted video and then ask his permission to publish it publicly as an edited down few minute video called Urgent Plea to Professor Guy McPherson. Just ask him. The worst he can say is no. All right, no. Right? But either way, we get the message to him. And either way, this meeting is certainly public, right? And,
yeah. No, sorry, again, I agree with that, because it's probably best that you broach that with him first anyway, rather than throwing a gauntlet down on, in front of him on a video that goes up live first, like, you know, give him the option anyway if he wants to, obviously. So, yeah, sorry, go on, carry on.
Yeah. But regardless, those who watch this video are going to know that, I mean, look, the urgency, Guy McPherson is in total agreement with the urgency, right? Where we've had disagreement in the past is on the tactics. He's focused on raising billions of dollars. And as far as I'm concerned, billions of dollars are but one of a long laundry list of resources that we need, which we need collective superintelligence to gather together in time. And that's the key thing. But much more valuable than the dollars there are the human resources that we're going to be pulling together, again, to simultaneously and holistically map out, analyze, and crack the code of each of the million steps from here to where we want to get to as a planet, as a species, as complex life on Earth, and where we want to get the planet to. All right.
Yeah, you know, all the money in the world is no good to anyone unless they have a plan to do something with it. Like, so.
That's right. And we need collective superintelligence for the plan. In fact, I think one of the great tragedies would be if he rounded up the money, but then we didn't have collective superintelligence to do good things with it, and he ended up getting shot down with all his billions, but still unable to convert that into real solutions, right? That would be a great tragedy. So let's avert that tragedy. But also, but back to the billions, we'll be able to raise billions of dollars much more effectively as a united collective superintelligence. And when I say united, please don't misunderstand anyone, including people watching this video. Please don't misunderstand that to mean that we all agree on everything. Quite to the contrary. In fact, there's the full range of beliefs and agreement and opinions and anything else. If anything, the spectrum will become even broader as we ramp up collective superintelligence. So disagreements welcome. What we need is the machinery with which to solve our problems. And we can be disagreeing about myriad things along the way, as long as we put out the fires. Look, you could have a bunch of firemen, a fire company, firefighters, who do not agree on anything except that they would need to put out this fire. And before the alarm goes off, they're arguing and disagreeing. They go out and put out the fire. And after the fire is put out, they can go back to arguing and disagreeing if they want. Right? We have a mission to accomplish together, regardless of what we agree on and disagree on. Let's agree on this. We need to save life on Earth. We need to cool the planet. We need to kill the coronavirus dead. That's one species, if you consider it a species. I know many biologists don't. It's probably not generally considered. But anyway, the one species I want to drive to extinction is corona. And if you can hear me. Pardon me?
I second that.
All right.
Yeah, and we need each other to do it. We all need each other to do it. So that's it.
But we finally have a common enemy that unites rich and poor, black and white, people from all continents of the world, young and old, gay and straight, male and female, XYZ, PDQ, LGBTQ, whatever, right? All the above. We finally have a common enemy.
That's for sure. This one's for sure.
We always had a common enemy, just most of us weren't aware of the most obvious ones, like, but the coronavirus is just one that's bringing people's attention to it.
Yeah, it's a common agreed upon enemy, right? That's what we have now, a common agreed upon enemy that we've never had before, ever, yeah. Ever. I mean, since the Spanish flu or whatever, right?
Yeah. And again, no, they're like the Spanish flu was mentioned earlier in a conversation I had with my daughter, Stephanie, earlier today, in text message and with somebody else I was talking about. See, what a lot of people don't remember or think about is with a pandemic is that, like, because we had brushes with different viruses over the last number of years with the H1N1 now and the SARS and everything else like that, people are kind of assuming that this is more or less something similar to it. But the difference with a pandemic compared to those viruses is very simple. How long it's going to last is not up to, it's not till the end of March, and it's not for 12 weeks, and it's not for 3 months. It's until we come up with a vaccine to solve the problem. And the thing is that even though it will seem to subside and die off for the summer period when the weather warms up, it by no means will be gone. It will only be mutating during the summer. And when it comes back, like the pandemic of 1918, the first winter, it killed 50,000 people. It mutated during the summer. It seemed like it died off. But when it came back for the second winter, it killed over 50 million people. So that's what's the difference with a pandemic is. 50,000 went in the first summer, or the first winter. It mutated during the summer, and the second winter, it was over 50 million people. Some say that because there was a lot of people that weren't reported, or the records couldn't be kept from most people, it could be well over 100 million people that died during that 1918 pandemic. So that's the severity of that situation we're facing. It's not just a virus, it's a pandemic. And it's something that can mutate and change again. So, you know, we're all in this one thing together. And yes, the pandemic is one thing, though, that's drawn all our world focus on. But we have to remind people that we have far greater problems than just that alone, which is why we all need each other, which is why we all need to focus, and which is why we all need to start talking, though, to help come up with solutions.
Yeah, it's quite clear to me now that this is inevitable, that collectives, that humanity coming together as a collective superintelligence is inevitable. And it's just, and the only question is, will we do it in time? And whoever you are watching this video, it is up to you. It is totally up to you. And if you think, oh, I'm only one of millions of people or one of a billion people, consider this. There is a tipping point that we're going to cross. It's probably somewhere in the hundreds of people actively and regularly using collective superintelligence, that once we cross that point, it will become such a thing that it will just take off exponentially from there. And we're probably on an exponential right now anyway. It's just, you know, it's a little slower than we'd like it at the moment, but that slowness, in turn, occasional slowness, like right now, 7 hours into our meeting. you know, minus a half hour lunch break and whatever, bathroom breaks and whatnot. But we, and in fact, I think we're due for a bathroom break anytime now. So we'll break for 10 or 15 or whatever people need. Let's just say it's, I don't know, 500, just to pick a number. You will influence how quickly we get to 500. And if we don't get to 500 in time to set off the exponential in time, to solve our problems in time, it's on you. Don't let this be on you. Join us now. Bring all your friends who are most ripe and ready for this conversation. Whether it's because they've read a bunch of sci-fi novels and know that it's possible, or whether it's because they can just feel it in their heart, right? Whatever the case, wherever they're coming from, you know who's most ready, or you've got a pretty good feel for it among your friends. So come and get ready to bring all your friends.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Even the bird was agreeing with you there, Jamen. As you spoke, the bird was chirping along with you, and every time you took a break in between sentences, he stopped as well. It was very good there.
Well, I think he's talking with me. It's actually a chipmunk, and he's really doing...
Oh, is it?
It's a chipmunk, and he's doing really great job. There he is.
Oh, yeah.
He's eating. We put food out for the wildlife every day, and there he is, and he's making that beautiful sound.
Oh, yeah, beautiful. It sounded like a little bird, all right, I don't know, but that's beautiful. Just that's a good thing, all right, because I've done that now every morning. First thing in the morning, I feed the birds, and before the sun sets, I feed them again, especially because a lot of insects are missing at this time of the year, and they're missing out on a lot of nutrition while they're nesting. But people forget that with everything that's going on. So you got to look out for the small things.
Totally. All right. Well, it's been 2.5 hours since our last break. Any comments anyone would like to make before we take a break? And I'm in no hurry to take a break. So comment away or question away or whatever away.
No, I'm just going to go grab a cup of tea anyway. I'll plug out my earphones, but I can.
Okay, well, I think we're about ready to break, probably. How long do we want to break for? 15 minutes? 20 minutes? What do people want? 20?
You decide, Jamen.
Yeah? Okay, James says 15. 15? 15 it is. All right. It's 6 after. Let's meet back at 6:20. It'll be 4:20 somewhere. So let's meet back at 6:20 or 6:21. All right, we'll see you guys in 15 minutes.
Send out the invitations.
Yeah. I mean, wait a second, Emery. Are you saying I should invite more people to come to this meeting? I can do that.
I could be kidding, but.
No, well, okay, it's a serious question. So let's let everybody weigh in. Do we want to invite more people to this conversation now, or just keep jamming the four of us, or what do we want to do? And we're still recording. In fact, look, I'm going to pause just to – no, why pause? I mean, what's there to hide, right? This is part of a process. We're modeling this process.
Let's jam it out, the four of us.
Okay.
Alyssa will be coming back, so.
All right. Okay, so just keep jamming. Yeah, because that way, otherwise, if people come in, then we kind of have to bring them up to speed. There would be value in that scenario anyway, but that can also wait till Friday.
Well, unless Guy shows up.
If Guy shows up, that's a different story. It's probably a bit late for him right now because he goes to bed on the earlier side.
I'd say it's a bit short notice now for that for a guy, you know, and that, like, but I was going to, when we go off, I'm going to switch off my camera. I'll message Stephanie anyway just to let her know we're still talking in case she wants to join in again. I'm not sure what happened to her there earlier. They might be gone out too, I'm not sure. But I think we would have a lot of explaining to do if we have someone back, a lot of people.
Yeah. Okay. All right, well, let's take 15 minutes. That'll be 23 after the hour. It'll be 4:23 somewhere. So we'll see you in 15 minutes. See you guys soon. I'm going to pause recording in the meantime.